Hi, I'm Richard Branson.
Mr. Branson, your spaceship is ready for blastoff.
I'll be right out.
Relax.
The new collection is only from Virgin Media, including TiVo with Sky Channels and super-fast fiber optic broadband.
Thank you.
Well, good morning. I hope you like our little intro clip. My name's Maurice Storr from Virgin Media. And just quickly to introduce myself, I've been with the company since 2008. I'm from operations, so I run field operations and supply chain. We look after the installation and service of our 5 million customers. There are 7,000 people in my organization, and we work with some great partners who help us do that. Just over half the people are Virgin people, and we work with people like McNicholas and Fujitsu, and I'm really pleased to see them here today. I've had a career in operations in the UK. For the English people, I've made Cadbury's Easter eggs. I've run the Marmite factory. I've made Ambrosia custard. And before joining Virgin, I worked in the technology logistics business with people like Vodafone, Apple, Three, and Sky. Crikey, I can't believe I gave them a plug. Jill, introduce yourself.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Jill Dean. I'm the CEO of a company called Powertrain, and we're a behavioural change consultancy. And we've been working with Virgin Media for the last 4 years. And Virgin is a very well-known brand, but Virgin Media is, in fact, the biggest organisation in the group. And I think perhaps we should start with a bit of information about them.
Yeah, so let me just quickly tell you about Virgin Media, particularly for people who aren't from the UK, because we are a UK-only company. Today, we are a 4 billion turnover company with some 20,000 employees, around 14,000 are Virgin people, and as I mentioned earlier, around 6,000 are dedicated partners. We provide TV, super fast fiber broadband, fixed line telephone, and mobile. We've also got a rapidly growing business division where we're providing connectivity to some of Britain's biggest companies, Britain's public sector, and other telecommunications companies. So, for example, we provide some of the backhaul for the data coming off your mobile phones for the mobile operators. We've just become a part of the Liberty Global Group. Liberty Global are now the world's biggest broadband communication company, and we now face a really exciting future as part of that family. Our market is really fast-paced, really dynamic, and we face some really strong competitors. We started life back in 2007 as a merger between three companies. We had two cable companies, NTL and Telewest, and Virgin Mobile. And those three companies came together in 2007. So whilst Virgin Mobile had an awesome reputation for great customer service, really, NTL and Telewest were the exact opposite. In fact, NTL was called NT Hell. And we faced a real challenge in the early days. I joined in 2008, and we had some real problems. We needed to create a single billing system. We needed to harmonize everyone's terms and conditions. We needed to transform our supply chain. We had 11 warehouses. We only needed one. And I led that team. But for the first 2 or 3 years, we became obsessed with making the business work, getting those processes work, getting our suppliers paid, getting our people paid. We really didn't focus on our customers, and we didn't focus on our people. In fact, we'd taken our eye off the ball.
Excuse me, mate. Yeah? You took your eye off the ball.
Yeah, too right. Okay, your eye was never on the ball. When Virgin Media took over, yeah, we thought things would be a little bit different. It's exactly the same. All right? So I'm sorry, I'm not going to listen to you say all this stuff. What's your name?
Morris.
Morris. That's a lovely name. How long you been in the company, Morris?
Well, I've been here 5 years.
Right, okay. How many times have you been out with the likes of me, out on a ride out, meeting the great British public?
Well, in the early days, I didn't really, because I was sorting out stuff in the head office.
Oh, right, okay, so you were in the ivory tower, yeah?
Yeah.
Right, okay, nice, comfy. Nice comfy chair, yeah? Yeah?
Yeah.
It's funny, isn't it? Because you know what? It's not funny for me, because I'm out there on the van, yeah? I'm out there visiting our customers, right? And I'll tell you what it's like, okay? We have to get through traffic jams. We have to deal with traffic wardens. We have to find somewhere to park. That's before we even get into a customer's house, yeah? And you think people are happy to see us? Right, look at him, yeah? The face he's given me, yeah? All the evils you're giving me, yeah? That's what we get, all right, from most of our customers. It's true, yeah? Because they've been mucked around by the call centre. I turn up, they see what I'm wearing, they see my outfit, and they think I'm the enemy, all right? It's true, and I'm there to help them, okay? So that's before we even get into the customer's house, yeah? And once we do, I can't even do my job properly, yeah? I'm a tech. The equipment we've got is out of date. The test equipment, I can't even do that properly. And all the time, you're saying to me that you want us to be salespeople. Upsell. Cross-sell. You think these lot will buy anything, yeah? Yeah, it's impossible selling, yeah? And you want us to be best friends with the customers. I'm sorry, that's not part of my job remit, all right? And you want us to do this 12 times a day. And do you know how long he gives us for it? Do you know how long? He gives us 30 minutes, all right? Yeah, you think it's funny, yeah, doing that 30 minutes 12 times a day. So quite frankly, Morris, you don't have a clue what it is like for us out there. My manager hasn't been out on a ride out with me for years, all right? So let me put it this to you, mate. We are set up to fail. Set up to fail.
So that was pretty... So actually, I did meet Mick. I did meet Mick in my first days at Virgin. I did a ride out, and it was very much like that. We were so obsessed with head office stuff, with processes, with getting things to work. We didn't really care at all about our people, and frankly, we didn't care about our customers. And our NPS scores reflected that. They were pretty awful. They were negative. We were not a great company to do business with. So when we set about the strategy of turning this around, we turned to the leader of the Virgin Group, Richard Branson, to get the approach that we needed to do. Because I wanted to get a strategy that says, does it feel like when you're a technician that there are 20,000 people behind me, willing me to do a great job? We just heard from Mick, and in 2008, 2009, you heard what he said. He didn't. He thought we were all there trying to screw him up. So our strategy of trying to turn it around was based on Richard's philosophy. Because what he says, very simply, is that traditional businesses are set up to look after the shareholders first, the customers second, and the employees a long way third. And I've worked in companies like that, and you have too. But what he says is you need to turn it around. You need to put your people first. You need to have well-trained, deeply engaged people. Those people will give you discretionary effort. Your customers will notice that. They will stay with you longer, spend more money with you, and start to rave about you to their friends and families. They'll become real promoters. And that is what will look after the shareholders. So, we set about that strategy in my part of the operation to put everything that we did through the eyes of our frontline people. Because I wanted our technicians to feel that there were 20,000 people behind them, willing them, making it so easy for them to do an awesome job for their customers. So it was a big task, and I could stand here all day and tell you all the stuff that we've had to do. But the really important messages come from some of the work we've done with Powertrain. So I'd like to invite Jill back up to talk about the help they've given us. So, Jill.
Thanks, Morris. So 4 years ago, our task was to turn Virgin Media into a Virgin business. And the task for us was the people bit and the behaviour, which, as you probably can guess from Mick, was no easy thing. So what we really wanted to do was to bring the Virgin brand to life in the organisation and to make their people understand it and to understand what that means you do for the customer. So we developed together a programme called Simply Brilliant. And actually the aim of it was to be, as it says, simply brilliant. And that was simply brilliant at delivering a customer experience, but also the employee experience. So I guess for us, the starting point was we needed to understand more about Mick. So as Morris said, he went out on rideouts and so did my team. And we went out there to find out about the sorts of things Mick was just talking about and what was going on and why was it going on and how was it affecting the people out there. And what we found out is Mick had right reason to be grumpy. And I think there's a few things to say about that, because at that time, Mick was dealing with the service end of the whole customer experience. So he was only called out when the customer had a problem. There was a fault, there was something going wrong, and he would be called out. So I guess to a certain extent, the customer's not going to be in the greatest of places at that stage. If you add to it that Mick was actually employed for his technical skills, you know, that's what he's good at. He's an engineer, he's a technician. He wasn't employed for his people skills, and we knew we needed to keep that in mind because we needed to help him learn how to do that as well as he did the technical stuff. So we knew we needed to get Mick on side, and we knew we needed to get all the people in the organisation on side. So how do you do that? Well, I think the first thing we recognised is that we needed to confront the realities of what Mick was actually up against out there. We really had to confront the issues of real life. You know, he was in, as he said, challenging situations with customers who weren't happy, with equipment that wasn't working, and he was pretty grumpy. And we needed to confront that. We needed to bring it out into the open. So actually, Mick appeared in every single event that we ran with the techs, and he did to them something like what he did to you this morning. And he had a rant, that's what he did. Because we knew we needed to demonstrate that the likes of Morris here actually understood what it was like out there. That he understood what the challenges were they were up against. And that, in fact, we respected what they were being asked to do with customers out there. But most importantly, we also knew we needed to give the techs the opportunity to see what effect that was having on Virgin Media customers. So why don't we do that now?
Look, I will call him. It's just tricky. I know he's frustrated. It's just I'm waiting for a technician to arrive so I can fix my set-top box. And it's the third time I've had someone round. I will. I promise. I will call him.
Hey, sir. Hi, Mick Sullivan, Virgin Media.
Hello. You're late. You're very late.
I'm sorry about that. It's just traffic was an absolute nightmare getting across town. I just wasn't able to find anywhere to park as well. So I'm actually on a double yellow, so I don't know what the traffic wardens are like.
The last two technicians that came to try and fix this fault had the courtesy to ring me to tell me they were going to be late. What makes you so special?
Well, look, I was just trying to find a place. I think it's new, so it wasn't on the sat nav, and it's just been one of those mornings. So, everything is.
Did you have any idea the impact your incompetence has on people like me trying to run a business from home? Do you have any idea?
Well, sir, I'm sorry. It's just been a hell of a morning. I wanted to get her as soon as I could.
Okay,
but
okay. Spare me the sob story. Let's just get on, yeah.
Okay. Right. So, that is the culprit there, yeah.
Well, if you mean the set-top box, yeah.
Right, okay. Right, so you've had a couple of people out already, you've got freezing images, and, third time lucky then.
What? What do you mean, lucky?
Well...
Where the hell does luck come into this? Are you a trained engineer?
Uh,
Yeah, I am a trained engineer. Yeah, many years service. So it's just a turn of phrase.
Yeah, it wasn't very funny. Can we just focus on it, yeah?
Yeah, sure, absolutely, sir. That's what I'm going to do.
What are you doing?
Well, what I need to do, first of all, obviously, I need to check the signal levels. So I've got my meter here.
No. The other two guys did that. They got that thing out. They checked the signal. It's all fine. It's not an issue, not a problem. So you can put that back in the bag and focus on what it really is.
Right, the thing is, sir, though, obviously, I wasn't there for those visits, right. Yeah?
Well, I was there, and they got that out, yeah. And it was fine.
Sure.
So can we focus on what the real problem is with this thing?
So I just really, I'm trying to help you here, and okay. Honestly, if I can just double-check this...
Well, then help me by focusing on what the real issue is, not on your wiry thing. Okay?
Right, fine, sir. You're the boss? You sure?
Yeah, in this situation, I am, actually.
Right, sorry, can I just get to the set-top box?
I'm not stopping you. Right. Well.
Right. Okay.
What do you think it
right,
is?
I need to nip back to the van. What I'm going to do is I'm going to swap this over for you,
no.
And then you'll get it.
No.
Because
no.
Then you'll get.
No, that is exactly what the other two guys did. Okay, they left the building. It was all working fine when they left the building. Kaput.
Yeah.
Okay. You're not doing the same thing.
Look, I can only like apologise for them, but like what? Look, if I'm trying to help you here, so if you let me go and swap this, then we can get it sorted. And we have had some faulty boxes recently, so what I'm hoping is that one's going
to... Oh, OK, so you've been trying to fob off faulty equipment on me.
No,
Do you realise how much of a joke your company is?
I'm just trying to get this sorted for you, and
oh, just
if
get
you
on
let
with
me
it.
Go to...
Yeah, get on with it, please.
All right,
yeah.
Do you want me to leave the door on the latch, yeah?
Just do it.
Back in a minute, right? Grumpy git.
Well, I guess it's true to say that we've just met a grumpy customer. What I can never say in this moment is that the situation you've just seen and the characters you've met are not based on true life, because they are. And when we went out on our ride-outs, this is the sort of thing that we saw happening. But it was really important for this programme with the techs that we showed them the effect of what they were doing on customers. And that we got them to understand what it felt like from the customer's point of view to be on the other end of that. And I guess what's important here is the fact that these techs, going back to what I said a few moments ago, were great at the technical bit, but actually had to learn how to deal with people. And on the program that we ran, what we did is dug a bit deeper. We tried to get to know some of the characters a bit more and tried to understand where they were coming from and why they were doing what they were doing. So in fact, I'd like to just do that for a couple of minutes here today so that you can understand a bit more about our customer, David, and our tech, Mick. So if they'd like to come back up on stage.
Morning.
I'm going to stand well away from him in case he shouts at me. Could we start with Mick?
Yeah, sure.
Mick, could you tell people, how do you think that went today? How was that?
Oh, it was a nightmare. It just felt so awkward and uncomfortable. Like, from the minute I got there and I'd had a nightmare journey, he answered the door and he looked like he wanted to kill me. Everything I tried to do, kind of just backfired and seemed to wind him up. And it got to the point I just was like, you know what? I can't do the job I'm meant to do, and I just wanted to get out of there because I've got another, I've got about another 10 jobs to get to, so I'm hopefully going to be able to make it up along the line. But it was a write-off.
And do you enjoy your job, Mick? Do you like what you do?
At this moment in time, no. You get days when I do, when I will get all my 12 jobs done, and I don't hand jobs back. And I will get comments from people about, how happy they are with the installs that I've done and the service I've given. And I try and be polite, try and be friendly. And every now and then you get people like the customer you just saw me with. And it's hard not to take that personally. Do you know what I mean? Because you're out there often on your own in the van. It's a solitary job. And you have people like that getting at you. You take that home with you. Of course you do. I'm only human.
And I guess what would be good to know is, in terms of what happened there, do you think the way you handled it and the way you went about it had any effect on what happened? Do you think it made it worse?
Yeah, I mean, look, I'll be honest, hands up. I should have given him a call before I arrived to let him know that I was running late, and I didn't, hands up. And when I was in there, I should have checked the signals, but I tried to do that. You saw me. I got out my signal meter checker, but he wouldn't let me because he's standing. Sometimes they do that. They stand right over you. They breathe down your neck. So he thought he knew my job better than me. And quite frankly, at that point, it's just like you cut your losses and you get out. And I know I'll get my knuckles wrapped for it by my manager, I know full well, but what else could I have done?
Okay, thank you. Thanks. David, could we just speak to you for a minute?
Yeah.
How was that experience for you?
Pathetic.
Oh dear. Can you tell us a bit more about why? Why was it pathetic?
Okay, well, this is the third visit I've had, and I want to start calling clients, okay? But I don't know when Muggins is going to turn up and try and fix my fault, so I don't want to be interrupted. He arrives, and I just want the stress taken away from me. I've got enough stress as it is. And all I felt with him is he was just adding to my stress, which is not what I expect.
Do you think perhaps the way you were with him had any effect on the outcome?
Yeah, it probably rescued the situation, if anything. What's the matter? I mean, if I hadn't focused on getting him to behave himself and focus on what he needed to do, there'd have been a real problem.
And I guess the ultimate question then, in the NPS, what score would you give him out of 10?
Well, he didn't swear. He didn't nick anything. 2.
Okay, thank you. I think we've got the picture there.
Okay.
I think the issue is, if you think about what you've just watched, is you had two very different people there coming at it from two very different places. And actually, it's not that easy to deal with someone like him. That customer is actually quite intimidating. And what we knew we needed to do was to equip the mix of the world with those people skills to understand how do you actually deal with someone like that. You know, and he's not typical of every customer, but if you accept what we believe, which is that we're not all the same, and, you know, going back to the first presentation today, you know, you look at customers through personality and think, well, how does that translate into how somebody actually behaves? Then that's what we wanted, and that's what we introduced to the text, the whole power of personality and how you use that, how you harness it to deliver a customer experience. So what was really important, first of all, was that Mick understood himself. So in watching these sorts of scenarios, what our techs were able to do was to recognize themselves and think, well, that's me. And actually, that's what I'm good at, as well as the sort of problems it might give me, particularly if I'm dealing with someone who's not like me and doesn't want to be treated in the way I want to treat them. And at Powertrain, we very much believe to get NPS scores of 9s and 10s, you have to learn to treat people as individuals. You have to understand what makes people tick, and you have to learn how to actually adapt your behavior to meet their requirement and deliver their experience. But we kind of knew that what was really important was to confront that reality, was to give them a program that they could relate to and that looked like what they do in real life, that did allow them to understand what made people tick. But we also knew, just because we told them to do it, they weren't going to. And I hope, a bit like today, you've experienced one of the other things that we strongly believe in, which is about how do you create an emotional impact in an event that makes people or wins people's hearts as well as their minds? Because it's a sad and true thing that logic does not change behavior, it simply informs. And what changes behavior is when you have those moments, toe-curling moments, and I'm not sure who it was that Mick picked on in the audience as the grumpy customer earlier on, I couldn't see who he was looking at, but whoever you were, you may have had that toe-curling moment, you may have had the moment of embarrassment, you might have been watching some of that and thought to yourself, God, I could get up there and sort that out and do that better. And that's what starts to change behavior, is to let people experience something that they see themselves coming the other way, that they can relate to, that they can try out the personality stuff that they've learned, but actually, emotionally, with the heart rather than the mind, they're thinking about and actually working out how to do this differently. So what was really important is that our guys practiced, and that's what we did during the program. We gave them lots of opportunities to practice. But I have to say, we had another problem. Because at Powertrain, we believe that what we're trying to do, we're trying to put the science behind behaviour. And what we call this is brand biology. And what we're about is trying to help everyone in the organisation apply this. So our other problem was a group of people between Morris and the techs, which were all the managers. And I'd like to show you what that problem was.
Oi!
Yeah.
Mick, get your bum in here.
Well, I got my job.
I've got Tony to do your first one.
Really?
Come on. Get in here. Sharp.
All right. How you doing? You all right? Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, it's quite nice, our first job off, I guess. We got Rose's third birthday party this weekend, so we're getting a marquee and everything, because I think it's going to probably rain again, so... What are you up to? You got plans?
No. Okay, I've called you in because there's a couple of issues I need to discuss with you.
Right. Sounds serious.
Well, potentially it is. First off, you're hitting target in terms of number of calls, average number of calls made per month. You know, you're getting your 12 in a day.
Yeah.
But what concerns me here is there's three occasions when you haven't hit 12, you've only hit 10. So I want to explore that with you.
Well, I mean, that's three out of the whole month.
Let me finish. There's also, reading the screen here, the number of set-top box swaps you're making is getting higher, okay? Comfort swaps, as we call them.
Well, no, I mean, we don't call them that, and they're not. That's not a phrase that we use out there.
Yeah, but it's what they are. It's when you don't know what you do, so you just swap the box.
No,
so,
it's not... Right. With all due respect, it's not.
Okay, so what I have here...
It's more complex than...
What I have here, and I need to show you, is a league table. Technician names here, number of set-top box swaps here. Now, this is a league table you do not want to be the top of. If you're the top of this, you do not get promoted. Can you just read the name at the top of the list there for me? You read it?
Yes, it's my name, isn't it?
Yeah,
so
Mick Sullivan. Is that you? Okay, so we have a problem. Now, I'm going to work with you on this, because I don't need to point out how much it costs us every time we swap a set-top box.
No, I'm just going to say my defence, yeah? All right, you look at that list, yeah?
Yeah.
All right, my name's at the top, yeah, but there's a lot of the other lads are there as well. I'm not dobbing them in, but as you can see, you know, all of us are doing this, yeah? A part of the reason is because you're constantly saying we need to get it fixed first time for the customer, get it done quickly, yeah? That's often the quickest solution. And on top of that, yeah, over the last month in the patch, there have been a load of set-top boxes that have been faulty, yeah? So, you know, that's not been our fault.
Okay,
so
can I just stop you there a minute?
That's why.
There's 2 points you've raised there. You've talked about other technicians. Well, don't worry. You know, I've got all the data here in front of me. I will get to them one by one. Now, in terms of faulty equipment, now I've got no data, no evidence to support the information you're giving me there. So there's nothing on my computer
But Nigel, I'm telling you now.
Well,
I'm telling you from the front line there is.
Yeah, well, I'm telling you, and I'm your manager, so you need to listen. So, that obviously, what's happening is you're not diagnosing the fault correctly.
No, I'm sorry, I'm not going to stand for that. Honestly, I've been in this job long enough, I do diagnose the faults correctly, but I tell you what, Nigel, when you are out there with some customers, they will not let you. You try and do the diagnostics, they will not let you do it properly.
Okay?
Whoa, doing my job.
Whoa, put your attitude back in the box, all right? Don't bring that into the room.
An attitude.
It's not helpful.
I'm just
Who's
trying
it helping?
I'm trying to explain what
Who's
it's
it
like
helping?
Out.
Nobody. Okay?
So I'm trying to explain to you.
I have got, let's focus on solution, okay, rather than problem. You know, I'm trying to be constructive here with you. So what I'm prepared to do is book out a morning with you. You can come out with me, do some service visits, and I will show you how it's done. I'll do it, then you'll do it. I'll give you some feedback.
So you're going to come out and meet customers with me, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll be first.
What? What did you say?
That'll be fine.
Okay. Good. Yeah. Okay, so we'll do... I've got a window Monday morning, I can squeeze you in there.
Right, so, no, I mean, Mondays, as you know, we get 16 jobs on a Monday. Right. That's the worst day, because often you've got the backup there, so...
That's good, you know, we're under pressure, that's fine.
But I don't think that's the right...
You know, look, I'm trying to support you here.
I know, I just don't think that's the right day for it
right.
to...
Okay, well, Monday it is. We'll nip this in the bud before it becomes a serious problem. Okay, so I'm just trying to help you out. That's all, Mick. I think that's me done. Everything else okay? Yeah? Yeah? All right. Well, you've got a few minutes free now, so if you want, you can grab a coffee. It's number 23 on the machine, I think. All right?
Great.
All
right. Thanks, Nigel.
Yeah. All right, you take care. Good talking.
Yeah, grand.
I think you could see what the problem is. So what we knew, we needed to do something about the leadership and about the way that these guys were being managed. But I think we should do what we did a little bit earlier, just quickly, and ask our manager, Nigel, and Mick to come back. And let's just find out a little bit about what they thought about all that.
Hello, that's a nice dress.
Thank you, Nigel.
Yeah.
So could we start with you, Nigel?
Yeah.
Was that a pretty typical meeting with one of your techs?
Well, it is with Michael. He's very difficult, so you've got to be very clear with them. You've got to make sure you're prepared, have all the statistics in front of you. Ultimately, that's what we're judged on, and really nail the message. Hmm.
You did go on about the statistics a bit, didn't you?
Well, unfortunately, what's your name, sorry?
Jill,
unfortunately, that's what we're ultimately judged on. You know, if we don't hit the stats, we don't get paid.
Right, okay. How do you think Mick felt about that conversation? How do you think Mick felt about that conversation?
Felt.
Yeah.
Well, I don't really see that feelings need to come in on it. You know, I mean, basically, he's not hitting his target. So he needs to rectify that. So the main thing is he gets that message, you know. If I worried too much about what everybody was feeling, you know, I'm not sure what we'd achieve, you know.
So do you think what you've decided to do is going to work?
Yes.
Good. Shall we go to Mick for a minute?
Hi.
Hi, Mick. How was that for you, that meeting?
It was just a waste of time, you know. To be honest, it's like, that's time of my life I'll never get back. I mean, gone. And it's like talking to a brick wall when you talk to him, because it's all about figures, it's all about numbers, it's all about stats, and using that phrase like comfort swap, you know, that he has no idea what it's like, you know, and questioning my professionalism, like I'm not doing my job properly, and I've asked for support. Yeah, and me and the lads are always saying to the managers, please come out with us, but not like this. Monday's going to be a nightmare, because he'll be standing over my shoulder, and it's the worst day of all. That's not the support I wanted. Mm-hmm. Not at all.
And do you think it's going to work, him coming out?
No, it won't. It's just going to add more pressure, yeah? And he's not going to listen to anything. And I'm dreading it, yeah? And I've got my daughter's birthday coming up this weekend. Am I going to be able to enjoy any moment of that? No, because of what's happening on Monday. So another weekend ruined. Very nice. Very
okay.
nice.
Thank you, both of you.
Sure.
I think what's probably important to say at this stage is, if you can imagine in the programme, what we actually did is showed that to the managers as well. So in the same way as we had with the techs, we showed them what the effect what they were having on the customer, we showed the managers the effect they had on their staff. And actually, when you hear things like that and you hear it from the heart, the way Mick was telling us then, it does make you think, I have to do this differently. Because go back to Morris's challenge, how do we get 20,000 people to actually be supporting these techs, and how do we get the techs to feel like there are 20,000 people behind them? And to be fair to the managers, they were being measured on stats. They were being driven to behave in that way, and we really needed them to become supporters and coaches. And that's how we went about it. We got into their program, the whole mindset of trying to think about and creating an employee experience and being there for your people. So I guess it's back to the title of the session, Grumpy Tech meets Grumpy Customer. This can't end well, or can it? Well, can I go back to Morris to answer that question?
So,
So here we are now, it's 2013. I have to say it's been a huge success. We've got record levels of engagement. We measure engagement of our people, and we've got some of the highest engagement in the whole of Virgin Media. We've got an engagement index of 86%, which is pretty stunning. It's higher than some of our offices, which is quite an interesting statistic. But it really does feel now, starting to feel really like there are 20,000 people behind them, as Jill was saying. And you'll probably all be interested in our NPS score. So we've gone from pretty horrible negative country, and we're now really nicely positive. I've taken the Y column off in case there's people from Sky, BT, or whatever here. But we're very proud of our NPS scores. We would be in that bottom box of the survey. We put 10 points on in the last year, and we're still pushing on. So we're really pleased with the NPS scores we get for our join and get help journeys. But I've got some interesting research I wanted to show you, which I think is really powerful and backs up what we've been talking about today. So this is some research from 6 months of 2012, live data from Virgin Media. And on the left-hand column, it talks about if you fix my fault or if you don't fix my fault. The middle column is what are your behaviours, and on the right-hand side is the resultant NPS score. Now, this is a huge pool of data, so this is statistically completely valid. And if you look at the top and the bottom, it's pretty obvious. If you fix my fault first time, and I notice that you're friendly, polite, and helpful, I'll give you a 9 or a 10 almost every time. But if you don't fix my fault, and you're a bit grumpy, and you're not very helpful, I'll equally score you 0 almost every time. But the interesting bit for me is in the middle. So if you look in the middle two points, so if you fix my fault, but you're rude, you're unhelpful, i.e. your behaviours aren't right, I'll score you negative NPS. And worse still, and really interesting, is if you don't fix my fault, but actually you're polite, friendly and helpful, you'll be about 0. So we've spent the first 4 or 5 years being Virgin Media trying to fix processes, get the company to work, deal with first-time resolution, and we've had this light bulb moment over the last year or so that actually it's all about behaviours, just as importantly, and behaviours are the thing that really is now driving up our NPS score. So it's made us also think pretty deeply about our operating model. How do we run our field operations? So we sat down just over a year ago and worked out what would actually be the best way of installing a customer, both technically and behaviourally. What would be the best way of coaching these people? What would be the best processes we could follow? What was the best training we could give them? What was the best ratios of managers to technicians? And so we actually ran that model, and we ran it in Manchester through 2012. We doubled our NPS scores. We hit plus 60. We had almost perfect engagement. We had 98% of our workforce in Manchester, some 60 people feeling that they loved Virgin Media. We didn't have a single customer complaint from Manchester in 2012. So what we've done is we've now rolled that right across the northwest of the country, which is a big region for us, about 20% of the UK. And we're going to run it this summer to see what learning we can get from that and whether that really is the future to awesome customer experience and great employee engagement. So I wanted to give you some feedback of what those guys are saying. So we're going to run a short video of what the guys on the front line in Manchester are feeling about their Project Iris, as it's called. What's it like to work in the Northwest? Just watch this video.
The Iris project is all about bringing in house the one-man install service work. We realised there's a need to improve the standard of installation, the customer service, the engagement with the customer. When it was initially communicated to the team, there was trepidation from a lot of the workforce.
I wasn't happy when I was put into the project. I was a service engineer. I wanted to carry on being a service engineer and I didn't want to do installations.
I was sceptical about it because it will affect a whole lot of different things. in regards to the customers, the engineers and all that. So I was a bit skeptical in that way.
When it first started, we identified a lot of needs within the business and training needs. So we worked on that and we developed that and worked through all them.
You've got your AFCs, your access field coaches that are on the end of the phone all the time. If you come into a bit of trouble out in the field and you need a bit of advice, you can ring them.
They are there when you need them, and that's very satisfying to know that you're not there on your own.
If the technician can't rectify that problem, either install or service job on the actual day, it can be escalated. There's a set process to escalate through the manager.
The teams are saying now that they enjoy coming to work, they love the team ethic that's going on. There's a real buzz and communication across the whole of the Iris project.
The main change for a technician is that you've got more backup now. You've got the backup of your colleagues in the team and the coaches, and the managers seem to be more behind you.
If you're struggling, you've got your back office that are monitoring your routes during the day and can move jobs about and make sure you're finishing on time.
There should be nobody working late, again, but there's nobody finishing early. So everybody finishes at the same time, everybody's helping out. So it's a real team ethos.
You wake up in the morning, turn your PDA on, and you know what time you're finishing. You know you're going to be home at that time. You know you can ring your missus and say, you know, tea can be ready for that time. You can see your kids before they go to bed. All that kind of stuff. It makes a big difference to your own life.
Had the time to do the installs. You had the resources to do the installs. That's why it became better. You didn't have to rush through or anything at all like that. It came better that way.
You know what the job you've done is right. It's spot on. You do get a good amount of satisfaction.
The impacts seen from the customer would be the huge improvement in quality, a huge improvement in technician engagement with the customer, and the confidence that when the technician leaves the house, that they're leaving knowing that there's a full working service.
We're getting time to do the job, so the customer's not feeling that it's rushed, and they're just a lot happier with the installs.
The service that the technicians give to the customer, customer education, fault finding, first time fix. So there's a whole remit there for improvements for the customer. So it's a good thing all round.
So the customer is just, we provide a better service. They don't really know our infrastructure of Iris and all that, but it's just better service for them. More in time service, more in tune service, that is.
We coach you through and we spend time, and it's not just a 2 minute, this is how you do it, sign here. It's in depth, knowing, and we can go away at the end of the day knowing that they're happy and have the knowledge.
It has an impact on NPS, as in the more time you get to spend with a customer, the more comfortable a customer feels. The more you can explain to a customer how the service works, yes, it will make a difference on the NPS. It does make a difference on NPS.
What's worked well about the project has been the increase in quality for the customer, the increase in confidence for a customer, which we've seen through NPS, which we've seen highs of plus 50, which has been record-breaking.
The customers don't really directly say anything to us, but we get a lot of feedback through the NPS.
The NPS has been a great result and a surprise, but it shows that when you give the technicians the tools to do the job and the means to do the job and the correct coaching, then anything's achievable. For other managers about to embark on a project like Iris, there will be some culture change. We are on the field so much more than managers have been in the past. We'll be taking your one-to-ones on the field, taking your team meetings onto the field. So there is a big culture change, but once you make that step, you do realise that it's a step for the better.
My advice to anybody would be just give it a go. You'll find that it's not as bad as you think. And in a lot of cases, a lot of days' works are actually easier than doing 16 service calls.
What I'd say to the technicians who are about to come into the project is it's quite simple, just embrace it. You've got the technical support, you've got the support from your peers, support from the coaches, support from the managers. It'll be a real positive thing all round.
Just focus. It's a good place to work, Virgin Media. Just keep focused, doing what you need to do, and you'll love it. If you want to be an engineer, you'll love this job.
What would I say to the technicians coming over? I'd say it'll change their working life, it'll change their own life, and they'll be a lot happier coming to work.
some really strong feedback from the guys on the front line. That video was shot for another reason. We didn't shoot it for today, and that was some really honest feedback. And it really does, I guess, in summary, bring together what we've been trying to say today, that actually it is all about power to the people, putting your people first, putting them at the heart of everything you do. Give them the tools for the job. You've heard today about not having the right test equipment, not having the right training, not having the right support. So make sure you give them the tools for the job. Make sure you incentivize them in the right way. We now pay our technicians a bonus when they get a 9 or a 10. The top guys in the country take their wives or partners out, and we don't go around the world like the Russians. We went to Madeira in the spring, and they had a 5-star long weekend on us. And it's also about great support. Again, you've heard today about the importance of the first line manager, the importance of coaching, and the importance of really making sure that those guys have got all the help that they need. And we just deeply believe that engaged people give you discretionary effort and your customers notice. Manchester has proven that. Now, I have to say, we are not perfect. You know, we have got a long way to go. There's lots of things we're trying to improve. So please don't think we're standing here today feeling very smug and it's job well done. We've got a very challenging market, very challenging customers, challenging technology, and we've got 7,000 people out there that we've got to try and lead and help along the way. So I guess there is some real humility with this as well. But Jill, do you want to summarise from a customer point of view? I've talked about it from a people point of view. What about the customer?
Well, I think in true NPS style, it's actually what the customer thinks that matters, not what Morris or I or all his employees. And we thought we'd share with you, just to finish and bring the session to a close, some actual verbatim comments from customers that Virgin Media has received in recent times. And we thought, actually, the ones we've picked, I think it's really important to point out a couple of things, because it doesn't just show that Virgin people are trying to deliver the customer experience and trying to do a really good job. It really shows that they're trying to go the extra mile. They're really trying to get those nines and tens by doing something quite special.
Your engineer came on the day I moved in. It was a busy day, but he was so very helpful. Not only did he install the television and help me set it up, he also helped me move a couple of pieces of furniture that the removal men had left in stupid places. I'm disabled, so this really made a difference to me. I was so appreciative, and I hope this doesn't get him in trouble. He really couldn't have been more helpful.
My young daughter is addicted to Raster Mouse, and we had a fair few of the programmes recorded on the old box. Of course, when that had to be replaced, we realised that we'd have to lose the recordings. I explained this to my daughter, and she was really upset and shed a few tears. The engineer was so kind. He explained that she'd be able to record more shows in the future. But that wasn't it. I was stunned when later in the day he actually called me to say that if I put the TV on now, Raster Mouse was on, and he reminded me how to record it. Unbelievable.
He just made us feel that nothing was too much trouble, and even made sure all the other Virgin services were tested before he left. And all of this on a Friday evening at 7 o'clock.
The integrity of Virgin is outstanding compared to any other company or organisation I have ever come into contact with. There is no one else out there who respects and treats their customers the way Virgin does.
Right, thank you.
Can I just say one or two final things? First of all, thank you for listening to our session, and I hope you found it enjoyable and useful and interesting. But I think I'd really like to introduce you to two people who've taken a major part in this, and they are our actor consultants, Andy and, are you both there? Yeah, Matt.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
Thank you. And I'd like to say a huge thank you to the guys who actually brought the van in. So the van's come down from Stoke-on-Trent, and the van driver is sat at the back. He's Andy Waslow. He's from Stoke-on-Trent. Andy, where are you? Can you... I can't see. Right, Andy, come on up. Because Andy... Andy, come here. Andy is the highest scoring MPS technician in the country today, and I'm going to give him an iPad mini to say thank you very much. Well done. Well done, mate. Here we go. There we go. Real Virgin Media. Thanks very much. Thank you.